I wanted to become an entrepreneur myself when I went to school, but I was never facilitated. So what I see is that a lot of entrepreneurship programs are offered by people who are not entrepreneurs themselves. And we're not educating for researchers, we're educating for entrepreneurs. Yeah. The subject experts are from the field. We have global entrepreneurs teaching. When you're teaching from the book, you're teaching outdated content.
A warm welcome on 7D TV with a new interview with my guest, Thomas Blackman. And Thomas Blackman is co-founder and dean of the Global School for Entrepreneurship. A warm welcome, Thomas.
Thank you, Ronnie.
A Global School for Entrepreneurship. How did the whole project start in the beginning? And why?
it started some 3 years ago.
Yeah.
When Timo Timmerman, my co-founder, and previously he started two universities before. Yeah. He asked me if I would like to join him to create a bachelor program of 4 years from a blank sheet of paper. Mm. So 3 years ago, I didn't even know I would own a University of Applied Sciences.
Mm. And why? Because there are a lot of...
We really want to change entrepreneurship education.
Because it's not good?
No. No, it's ridiculous.
And how do you do that? I know how to start a company, but to start...
I didn't know either.
No.
I learned that from Timo. He has started University of Applied Sciences before.
Yeah.
And apparently what you need is an accredited institution. And once you have an accredited institution, you can apply for new programs.
Okay.
And that's what we did. So I'm the architect of the bachelor program.
Yeah.
We bought an existing University of Applied Sciences as entrepreneurs.
Ah, okay. And build on that one.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
So we only had to create
the content.
We had to create an entire new program.
Yeah. How did you do that?
Well, I started off at Erasmus, where I had a bachelor minor, but I was always limited to 3 months of teaching program with the students.
Yeah.
And I had to teach 90 students at the same time in one classroom. So we had to put them in teams, and they could never be facilitated personally.
Mm-hmm.
And not everybody wanted to become an entrepreneur.
Yeah, so the fallout was great. Yeah, you also see that in studies. A lot of studies is a lot of...
The fallout is insane.
Yeah.
But that's a whole different reason. Maybe we get to it later.
Yeah.
The thing is, what I wanted to do was extend the 3 months to a longer period, and then I got 4 years.
And you wanted to work only with students that have the ambition to become an entrepreneur?
Yeah, because I wanted to become an entrepreneur myself when I went to school, but I was never facilitated. So I ended up working at a bank of all places, and I did do innovation projects and stuff like that. So the innovator in me got satisfied, but the entrepreneurial part was still lacking.
And how difficult was the process before you really could open the doors?
It was quite a challenge because everybody told me this cannot be done.
Mm-hmm.
This is not the way we do programs. And I didn't want to put students in a classroom for half a year and then do theoretical exams.
Yeah.
I wanted to be facilitated hands-on by entrepreneurs, because what I see is that a lot of entrepreneurship programs are offered by people who are not entrepreneurs themselves.
They're not credible.
I don't get it. Yeah. There are researchers studying how others do it.
Yeah.
That's how we build up the whole myths about entrepreneurship. Mm-hmm. That you need to be a risk taker, need to be visionary. And it's insane because they just don't understand. Because mm-hmm. if an entrepreneur tells them that they're taking risks and that they have had a vision, they write down vision, high risk taker, because they don't know.
Yeah. So the people that do the education are all entrepreneurs themselves?
All entrepreneurs.
Okay.
We state on the website 75%, but we're doing better than that.
Okay.
Because I can't work with people that don't understand what the students are going through.
And the students are going through the development of creating their own...
From day one.
Aha. So it's not like you learn theory and then when you're graduated, then you can possibly...
No, that's maybe, the problem.
Yeah.
Because what happens, then you have 4 years of studies, then they go and try to start, but then they only have limited time because they want to start a household or they want to. And then they have limited time.
And study time is a great time to start a company.
It's awesome.
Yeah, they have nothing to lose.
No. And we actually freed up the agenda during the week so that they can really work on it and get facilitation from experts. They get coaching from learning coaches. They are in it. We are in an incubator environment.
That's exactly what I wanted to ask. It's almost like an incubator.
Well, it is. If you cannot share this with anyone.
No. We won't. Because it's an official study.
But it's actually an accredited incubator.
Yeah,
that's what it is. But because we facilitate the incubator with modules, and we have assessments every 5 weeks.
Yeah.
And those assessments are actually building blocks of your business.
Yeah.
And those get assessed. And then you also get a bachelor degree at the end. But the whole goal is to get you started to run a business.
Hey, but you don't finance. So you feed them with modules, not with investment capital.
We do. But not as if not the school. In our network, in our ecosystem, exactly. There is a company called Unknown Group. And Unknown Group is also one of the co-founders from Hendrik Halbe, and his team. And they are also part of Ventures One. And Ventures One is a venture capitalist. So we now have our first student going for venture capital.
Yeah, because I can imagine if I would be a venture capitalist, if I'm a VC, I definitely want to fly around your students and see if the new Steve Jobs
but
or
not
the new
from
Elon
the
Musk
start. Not from the start. Because first we need to help them get to credibility and get some traction and figure out what actually works and what doesn't. And then if it's big enough, then we help them to become successful in the process of getting funding. But it's not the goal as such.
No.
Because not every entrepreneur needs venture capital.
No.
It's an option.
Yeah, yeah. You can also just work, make profits.
And from your
money.
Own revenues, finance the growth.
Yeah. How are the results? Because you're 2 years now running?
We're running for 2 years. We're starting the third year now.
And the first year were how many students?
8.
And now?
80.
80?
Yeah. 8-0.
And where is it? Is it because we're doing this interview in 2020 now, so COVID-19 is there. Is it like a virtual place to study? Do you have physical places? Is the combination?
The thing is, we have really small groups that we facilitate. So it's a face-to-face education in Amsterdam. And there we have no more than 23 people in a classroom. Okay. On average, it's 18.
Okay.
But when COVID hit, we had to sort it because we were not allowed, because we are a fully accredited University of Applied Sciences.
Yeah.
So we were not allowed to do physical education.
Mm-hmm.
So we flipped the switch and we went to online.
Yeah.
Now that was already planned to be a project because our first students would go to Barcelona. Mm-hmm. So we were prepared. Mm-hmm. So within 3 or 4 hours, we were completely running online. Everything we did in the physical area, we did online.
Yeah.
And now we are actually offering a hybrid version. We call it the you choose policy. The student should feel comfortable in the classroom.
Uh-huh.
And if they don't feel comfortable online, they should be able to be in the classroom.
Yeah.
So even Harvard at the moment is doing residential living, but online classes.
Okay.
So we're outperforming Harvard at the moment.
Hey, you don't have any graduates yet, right?
We have one because one of the first 8 students was actually a transfer student.
Uh-huh.
So now he's finished his aptitude test. So we have the first graduate.
And does he have an enterprise?
Yes.
Okay.
But not as big as he wanted because he chose not to proceed with the one he had. And he's now starting a new one. But the way we test at the end is an aptitude test. So not a thesis, because we're not educating for researchers, we're educating for entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
So we want them to prove mastery of being able to build a new business. And in the last 3-4 months, he built a new business.
And how are the rest of the 80 students doing? Can you give me some insights about what kind of people are it? What are they doing? What are their ambitions?
What I'm really proud of is the fact that it's 45% is female and 55% is male.
Okay.
Which a lot of people don't expect because of the fact that it's entrepreneurship.
Yeah.
So we have people that are also successors to family business. One of the female entrepreneurs, Lieke, she has a grandfather in the medical devices.
Yeah.
And she had a really busy time during Corona. Mm-hmm. But then there's also a student from Brazil who has now opened a Brazilian restaurant. There are students who trade limited sneakers. So they have a platform where they sell limited sneakers. There's all different types of... there's a student that actually wants to become a corporate entrepreneur. So more business, so intrapreneur.
Yeah.
And he's now working with a hydrogen shipping. So there's all different, because the
yeah, because I can imagine that the profile of graduate student from your study can also be very interesting for corporates. So it doesn't.
Yeah, we have a how did we call it? I think it was the board of inspiration.
Yeah.
And there are corporates in the board that we talked to, and we showed them what the profile of the student that we were educating for and the program.
Yeah.
That we would love to have some students from your, once they're finished, in our business, because yeah, we also need to create new value propositions and do innovation.
Yeah. How international is are the 80 students from? How many?
They're from all over the world.
Yeah.
We were doing better with the averages. 40% now is not, is. Dutch, so 60%, no, for other way around. 40% is non-Dutch,
okay,
and 60% is Dutch. But that had to do with Corona, with the fact that our growth from the new group is coming largely from the Netherlands. But others in that group are from Mexico, Dubai, South Africa. They're from all over Germany. Oh,
okay. How unconventional is the way you teach?
I always find it difficult, because we put on the website it's unconventional education, is because they tell us, oh, this is rather unconventional.
Yeah.
But then when I get the question, I find it difficult to answer.
Because for you it's normal.
No, it's because it's really difficult to distinguish between what we do and what's already being done, because a lot of people know what's being done and they compare us to that.
Yeah.
And unconventional to us is that I took some, I have a background with leadership and executive development. And the way we did those programs was with a trainer who would be doing the group. And then there would be guest speakers coming in, mm-hmm. sharing knowledge. And then the trainer would actually do the learning process on what do we do with what is just being told. Mm-hmm. What do we take on? What don't we take on? Mm-hmm. What did we think of the speaker? Stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And I actually copied that model to our classrooms. Mm-hmm. So on every group of 23, we have a learning coach. And those learning coaches, when they don't work for in my classroom with the students, they coach executives. So we really have a high-end executive coach that is teaching the students how to cope with disappointment,
to reflect.
And so only that part is already insanely valuable to the development of individuals.
Yeah.
Then on the other hand, we have businesses, consultants from the market, who teach our content. So the subject experts are from the field. We have a growth hacking agency teaching growth hacking, and if they get a new tool or a new insight,
you know,
today it's in the classroom on Monday.
Yeah.
So I've written 3 books myself, and I know how long it takes to write the book, and then how long it takes to get it into a program. Mm-hmm. So when you're teaching from the book, you're teaching outdated content.
Per definition. Yeah. So what do you think of regular education?
Well, the thing is, I have to be a little bit respectful, because I worked for Erasmus as a clinical professor for quite some time. I started there at 2005, part-time, one day a week. I really love how serious they're taking it. And I had some really good colleagues. Mm-hmm. But the thing is that they are actually researchers and they also teach. But their primary interest in their careers is that what they're appreciated for is the researching and the writing of articles. Mm-hmm. I know of someone who was a colleague who was really excellent in teaching executive students. He loved teaching, but he didn't really manage his article writing process, and then he was just asked to leave. Mm-hmm. And that's the biggest issue. So there are researchers teaching students knowledge, mm-hmm. but you can Google knowledge. So what I see is also the memory quizzes at the end. They have multiple lectures and multiple modules during half a year. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the half a year, they have to study for their exams. And they pass, but after a month, they don't know anything anymore. Mm-hmm. Because it's short-sighted and it's only memory quizzes.
Yeah.
And we really want to build experiences.
Yeah.
So the way we educate is by applying. So branding is not reading the book about branding and memorizing steps. It's building your own brand book for your own company.
Yeah, it's a new way of...
It's different. That's also why we started the school in the first place.
It does cost more than 14K.
Yeah.
Is that, of course, that's a lot of money.
It's a lot, but that depends to what you compare it. If you compare it to Nyenrode or Tio, that's 18,000, 21,000. The thing is, we're not subsidized by the government. It has disadvantages and a lot of advantages.
Yeah. And what does that mean for the youngsters that come from poorer families and stuff like
that? They can finance the entire thing through Duo, which is the entity in the Netherlands that gives out loans for studying.
Okay.
And because we're fully accredited, they can finance it through Duo. And there's a lot of articles in the newspaper about the stress that that gives, having the loan.
Yeah.
But if you look at it as an investment in a company, we have so many students already making more than the tuition fee. They could choose to pay off. It's a stupid choice because it's the cheapest money an entrepreneur can find.
Yeah, that's true. But if you look at that that way, and if they have...
It's deductible too, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
Because they run a company.
Yeah, yeah. Do they all run a company?
99.5% I would say.
And
one is in between, not sure yet.
And how much of them are really going to be, you know, will have a future as a company? How many of the students that now are busy studying?
We cannot predict. No. So the bachelor degree is a fallback scenario.
Yeah.
But until now, we only see them going up.
Yeah. Is there already a little Elon Musk?
There's one of the students that's now going for an investment. Paul, he's from Paris, and he's built Sneakmart.fr in France.
Sneak Mart. Yeah.
And it's a platform where you can trade fashion, high-end fashion. And he's now going for an investment of 250,000 euros.
Yeah,
he's in his second year.
That's a startup scene that does. There's a lot of, there's a number of platforms that are doing
But he's doing it specifically for France.
Yeah.
He studies in Amsterdam, but he can perfectly build an online platform for France.
You're a global school of entrepreneurship. So are you already situated also in France and all over the world?
No, not yet. But
why do you name yourself global? That's ambition. Also entrepreneurship.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Now, the thing is, it's not just branding. We really have a vision. The thing is, we have global entrepreneurs teaching.
Yeah.
So one of our partners is the Anon Group, like I mentioned before. And they have Get in the Ring, which is active in over 120 countries around the world. Mm. They have pitching events. So there's a big, massive community of successful entrepreneurs, investors, and everything. And they teach our students with Ask Me Anything sessions. They contribute as guest speakers to modules. So there is a global knowledge already. And we are expanding from Amsterdam to cities like Berlin, Barcelona, Singapore, because we are in the student hotel, and the student hotel is opening 66 hotels throughout Europe, and I think also outside.
Yeah.
And we are using that foundation as a scaling platform for us, but also other options that pass by. Because, for instance, Singapore is with a partner that has an incubator there.
How would you characterize the next generation of entrepreneurs?
Well, it's difficult because I look at them all individually, and then I see the differences, and we try to tailor. So, talking about a generation, what I do think is that what I run into is that because of all the Instagram ads with people lying on the beach making big bucks.
Yeah.
And then the real story and real life hits them when they are trying to build it themselves. And then I think that perseverance, really putting in effort, time, some really get it and others are a little bit entitled. Mm-hmm. And we try to help them with the learning coaches to understand. And then you see massive improvements and personal growth.
Yeah.
So starting off with wanting to become something, but then the acknowledgement that the amount of effort that goes into it.
Yeah. So yeah, it's not an easy job becoming an.
It's not an easy job at all.
And do you see them wanting to make it a better world? Like
that's in the new generation. One of the things we have the bachelor for the. I wouldn't call it generic, but the broad sense of becoming an entrepreneur and the startup. We now have a green version of it, where we put people in teams that all want to build on a sustainability angle.
Yeah, which can be
big. But we're still, we tried this out the last year on social media campaigns and stuff like that. And what you see is that we're still a little bit ahead of the market. Mm-hmm. Because they do want it, but the thing is that a lot of people are postponing entrepreneurship because they still think that they should go to a generic university first and learn something before they turn entrepreneur.
Yeah. Is that a frustration for you that you have keep on fighting against that?
It makes also fun.
Yeah.
Because when someone tells me I'm doing IBA, I always have to laugh because are you going to turn manager? Yeah. And why would you do IBA? Because it's international. Okay, fine. Yeah. But why BA? And then so there's a lot of people that are choosing generic routes, mm-hmm. and we need to bend those patterns and to show them that there is a viable option to become an entrepreneur.
And you could also, because we talked a little bit before the recording, like it's also a little bit of a paradox, right? If we go entrepreneurship and education, because a lot of successful entrepreneurs weren't that good in education at all.
No, they tell you not to go to school.
Exactly.
What was the name of the founder of PayPal? He's actually paying people not to go to school and waste their time.
Yeah.
But that's in a sense where they pay a year what our entire program costs.
Yeah.
So that's different. Yeah. And at the same time, they don't have the type of process that we have.
Yeah.
So we are really coaching them on the job to start and have their business and grow their business.
Yeah, an incubator in disguise.
It's incubator.
Thank you very much for this conversation. And I wish you, I think you're going to get busy the next coming years because it's a growing market, right? Youngsters that want to
become. There are more and more people. That we have a connection with youth entrepreneurs, Jong Ondernemen in the Netherlands.
Yeah. Yeah.
And these groups are growing and growing. And more people want to become architects of their own life.
Yeah.
And to me, entrepreneurship is a lifestyle. It's not a job. Yeah. It's not. And we really want them not to go and turn and grow into the next Facebook or the. We just want them to be
architects of their own life.
Architects of their own life.
I think that's a good description of entrepreneurship. Yeah. Let's see if some of those talents one day can be in the position that you are now in the studio of 70.
I hope so.
Yeah, it would be lovely. Thank you very much for this conversation.
You're welcome.
And thank you very much for watching a conversation here on 70 TV. If you want to see more, hit the subscribe button on YouTube or watch our podcast. For now, thanks for watching. Bye.